बायोटेक्नोलॉजी के बाद The webinar is conducted with the objective of highlighting Pakistan's agri biotech institutes in order to project Pakistan's scientific credentials. We are very delighted and thankful to have a very distinguished panel for today's discussion. Now, let me introduce you to our speakers and worthy chair. The webinar would be chaired by a respected Lieutenant General named Khalid Lodhi. Lieutenant General named Khalid Lodhi, Ilal-e-Imtiaz Military, was commissioned in 1974. And joined Corps of Engineers in Pakistan Army. He has served in various command assignments as Commander Engineers, GOC, and Corps Commander. He also has served in staff as Deputy Engineer in Chief and Director General Staff Duties at GHQ. After graduating from Military College of Engineering, Command and Staff College Quetta, and National Defense University, he also remained on the faculty of all the three prestigious institutions. He also holds Master's degree in International Relations. He has served as Secretary of Defense for a short tenure and later served as a successful CEO and MD of a leading corporate organization. He is also on the board of governors of Strategic Vision Institute. Lieutenant General Naim Khalid Lodhi was also appointed as Defense Minister in an interim setup. He is presently a freelance writer and an eminent defense analyst. Our first guest speaker for today's webinar would be Dr. Shaukat Ali. Dr. Shaukat Ali joined Agricultural Research Council, PARC, as scientific officer in 2001. He earned his PhD degree from College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Zhejiang University, Hangzhou, China, in the field of crop genetics and biotechnology in the year 2005, with work on transgenic rice development for insect resistance. He joined the plant technology group at National Agriculture Research Center in 2006. In the year 2007, he reported for the first time in Pakistan presence of BT cotton in the cotton growing areas of Pakistan based on laboratory scientific evidence. The report was circulated to all the stakeholders in the country, which ultimately led to the legalized approval of BT cotton in Pakistan. He has credit of establishment of gene engineering protocols in various crops like rice, wheat, groundnut, tomato, etc. and isolation of new genes for stress tolerance. He developed a system at PARC for the BT genes testing and authentication. Dr. Shaukat Ali is known as gene biosafety regulator of the country. He is currently assisting as associate technical member for National Biosafety Center, Islamabad, nominated by Ministry of National Food Security and Research. He also is involved in the academic activities at PARC. He developed two postgraduate courses for PARC Institute of Advanced Studies in Agriculture, that is Plant Engineering, Genetic Engineering and its Application in Agriculture and Biosafety of Gene Technology. He has executed 7 projects since the year 2005 related to plant biotechnology and biosafety. He has published articles in more than 60 refereed international journals. He has supervised the thesis research of 17 MPhil and PhD students during the last 5 years. Currently, he is serving as Director, National Institute of Genomics and Advanced Biotechnology, NAHUT PIASA, at National Agricultural Research Center, Islamabad. Today, he'll be speaking on current dynamics of agribiotech in Pakistan. Our second distinguished speaker for today's webinar would be Dr. Sayyed Javed Khurshid. Dr. Sayyed Javed Khurshid worked 40 years for Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission in different capacities as consultant, advisor, DG Planning and Projects, Director of Biosciences, PAEC, and Executive Secretary of the Salam International Nathia Kali Summer College. He also served as President of Pakistan Nuclear Society 2016 to 2018 and Director at Large of Islamabad Chapter of Planning Management Institute, USA. Presently, Dr. Javed is working as a Senior Research Fellow at the Center for International Strategic Studies, a think tank. He is advising on mitigation of WMDs and CBRNs, nuclear knowledge management for SDGs, nuclear energy and climate change. Technical member of MOFA Internal Compliance Committee, Resolution 1540. He is a founder member of Friends of ICTP, Trieste, Italy. He is the Secretary of National Member Organization, IIASA Austria, and Friends of ICTP Pakistan. He's an advisor to the Institute of Medical Sciences, Cambridge. Dr. Javed Khurshid has more than 71 international and national publications and referee to many journals and on the advisory board of 4 international and national journals. He is also a fellow of Pakistan Nuclear Society and Chemical Society of Pakistan. Today, he'll be speaking on Pakistan's efficient use of agri-biotechnology for mitigating impact of climate change. Our third worthy speaker for today's webinar would be Dr. Yusuf Zafar Tamkhaimtiaz. Dr. Yusuf Zafar is the director on board of Pakistan Mercantile Exchange 2019 to 2021. He is also a senior advisor to a think tank, Center for Global and Strategic Studies, Islamabad. He is a member of Science Diplomacy Working Group of Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Government of Pakistan 2009 till date. Dr. Yusuf Zafar is also USTA Concurrent Fellow. Dr. Yusuf Zafar served as Chairman of Pakistan Agriculture Research Council from 2016 to 2019. He has over 40 years experience in life sciences and biotechnology. He joined Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission in 1979 and obtained PhD degree in 1986. He has done 3 postdoctoral research studies in USA and 1 in CNR, Italy. He has been the founding team member of National Institute of Biotechnology and Genetic Engineering, Faisalabad, and National Institute of Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, NARC, Islamabad. He established Agriculture Biotechnology Division in NIBG and developed several GM crops. He mentored over 15 PhD students and more than 86 MPhil and MSc students, and has published over 200 research articles, including chapters and books. Dr. Yusuf Zafar acted in high-profile position, including Director General, Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission, Minister Technical in Pakistan Mission in Vienna, Austria, and Project Management Officer, Technical Corporation, Department Asia-Pacific International Atomic Energy Agency, Vienna, Austria. His services were recognized by the government of Pakistan that awarded him the Civil Award Tamkhaimtiaz in 2004. And the International Cotton Advisory Committee, Washington, D.C., USA, that bestowed upon him the Best Cotton Scientist of the Year Award 2012. Earlier, PAEC awarded him Best Scientist in 2000. Today, he'll be speaking on peaceful uses of nuclear technology for enhanced agricultural output. Our fourth speaker for today's webinar would have been Mr. Kashif Salik. He is an Associate Research Fellow, Research Environment Climate Change Unit, SDPI. He had to speak on agri-biotech as an engine of growth for socio-economic development. But unfortunately, due to his personal reasons, he would not be able to join us today. Rules of the webinar. Before we proceed further, I would like to mention that this webinar will be conducted in the form of panel discussion, during which each speaker will be given 15 minutes. If anyone is having trouble hearing or viewing this webinar or is having any form of connectivity issues, please do mention this in the chat and we shall try our best to address the issues on our part. If anyone from the audience would like to ask a question, they will be requested to kindly opt for the Q&A option for their questions. Please do include your name as well as your organizational affiliation along with your question. The questions will be presented to our panel by the moderator during the questions and answers session accordingly. While we fully encourage you to participate, we request you to please brief in your questions. We shall try our best to ensure that all the questions get answered within our allotted time. Please further note that the opinion voiced at the SPI platform are independent opinions of the speakers and audiences and not the official policy of the SPI. This is an open house activity which will be reported in media. This session is being live streamed on our Facebook page. The full recording of this webinar will be available on the official website and YouTube channel of the SBI. If anyone would like to tag or post screen grabs of this event on their personal blogs, web pages, or social media, please do not forget to mention that the webinar was organized by SBI. Thank you, now I invite worthy Lifia journal, Naeem Khalid Lodhi, to give his welcome and introductory remarks. And Journal Lodhi, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Amber. Thank you for introducing each one of us. So, Khwateen Hazrat, jo log bhi hume sun rahe hain aur hamare bahut mohtaram panelist, sabko assalamu alaikum. Mera khayal hai ki aaj ki nishesh jo hai, bahut hi soodmand sabit hogi is lihaz se ki jis subject ko aaj humne take up kiya hai, ये नॉर्मली आम तौर पे आपको ना अखबारों में मिलता है, ना कोई इस पर ज्यादा बहस होती है टीवी पर, हालांकि ये हमारे लिए जिंदगी और मौत का सवाल है अगर हम थोड़ा सा इस पे गौर करें, क्योंकि ये जो बायोटेक टेक्नोलॉजी है और जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग है, ये जिन एरियाज को कवर करती है, जिसमें मेडिसिन भी है, हमारी हेल्थ भी है, एनवायरनमेंट भी है, फूड भी है, और फूड सफिशेंसी, खासकर जिस तरीके से हमारी पॉपुलेशन बढ़ रही है, कितनी अहम है, और इसके साथ और रिलेटेड खुद ब खुद जब हम एनवायरनमेंट और फूड की बात करते हैं, तो आप देखिए कि कंजर्वेशन ऑफ वाटर फॉर एग्जाम्पल, जो कि फूड की मॉडिफिकेशन से, जो मुख्तलिफ एग्रीकल्चर प्रैक्टिस हैं, इसमें अगर हमारी सही प्रैक्टिस हो तो हम पानी भी बचा सकते हैं, तो बहुत सारी चीज़ों को कवर करती है। तो मुझे यकीन है कि जो भी लोग आज जिन्होंने हमें ज्वाइन किया है या ज्वाइन करेंगे, वो इससे बहुत फ़ायदा उठाएंगे। मैं सिर्फ अपना थोड़ा सा एक्सपीरियंस आपको बताऊं कि मैं बात कर रहा था डॉक्टर साहबान से कि मैंने चूंकि बहुत सारे इराद देखे हैं, तो जब मैं जिस आप समझो वक्त में मैंने प्रैक्टिकली कुछ वाकई बहुत स्ट्राइड्स और आगे बढ़ते देखा है पाकिस्तान को, तो वो यूब खान के ज़माने में था। मुझे नहीं पता कि उस वक्त कौन सी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन थी, क्या थी, लेकिन एक दो बातें मैं आपके सामने रख देता हूँ। मुझे याद है मैं साफ ज़रा स्कूल में था, लेकिन इतना मुझे मालूम था कि पर एकड़ पैदावार जो हमारी गंदम की थी, वो ऐसे थी कोई 16 मन फी एकड़ या 18 मन फी एकड़। और फिर हमें पता चला कि वो मैक्सी पाक आई, उसके बाद और अब तो खैर बहुत सारे वो आ गए हैं, तो 36, 35, 40 तक चली गई। और मेरा ख्याल है कि आज भी हम शायद 40 के लगभग ही खड़े हैं, लेकिन वैरायटीज और आई हैं इसमें, जिसका मतलब ये है कि हमारे जो एग्रीकल्चर साइंटिस्ट हैं वो काम करते रहे हैं। उसके अलावा चंद एक ऐसी चीज़ें हुई हैं जो हमारे लोगों को एहसास नहीं है। फॉर एग्ज़ाम्पल, ये जो जिनको ब्रॉयलर चिकन कहते हैं, ये उसी ज़माने में इंट्रोड्यूस हुआ। अगर मैं समझता हूँ कि अगर ये चिकन और ये वाले अंडे इंट्रोड्यूस ना होते, तो पता नहीं हम प्रोटीन्स के सिलसिले में कहाँ पर होते, अपने दुम्बे और बकरे खा के ख़त्म कर देते या क्या था। तो ये बहुत बड़ी रिलीफ दरमियान में आई। उसके बाद मैंने देखा कि पाकिस्तान में पहले किनू नहीं होता था और माल्टों की इतनी इकसाम नहीं थी। अभी आप देखें कि किनू हमारा बेहतरीन, शायद सबसे ज़्यादा एक्सपोर्ट होने वाला फल है। इसी तरीके से आमों की वराइटीज़ पैदा हुई। तो हमें गैर महसूस तौर पर जो फ़ायदा पहुंचाते रहे हमारे ये साइंसदान, हमने कभी उनका उस तरीके से तذکرہ नहीं किया जैसे कि होना चाहिए। आज तक मुझे यकीन है कि चावल की हमने पैदावार में बहुत काम किया है, और अभी जैसे अंबर कुछ बता रही थी कि ये डॉक्टर साहबान जो यहाँ मौजूद हैं और PARC ने जो काम किए हैं वो बेशुमार होंगे, लेकिन ना तो किसी ने उसकी तशहीर की ना उसकी तौकीर की। तो मेरे ख्याल में कि ये कटिंग एज टेक्नोलॉजी है लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, ये मतलब कोई ऐसी साइंस नहीं है जो कि मिड लेवल की साइंस हो, ये मॉडर्न तरीन चीज़ों में है, ये बायोटेक्नोलॉजी और जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग। तो मैं ये समझता हूँ कि आज हम बड़े खुशकिस्मत हैं कि हमारे साथ ऐसे लोग मौजूद हैं जिन्होंने ये सब कुछ पढ़ा है, पाकिस्तान को दिया है, और ज़्यादा तकाज़ा हमसे नहीं किया है, जबकि इनसे कम ऐसे लोग जिन्होंने कम कंट्रीब्यूट किया है उनको हमने बहुत बुलंदियों तक लेकर गए हैं। तो मेरी डॉक्टर साहबान, शुरू से ही मैं कौम की तरफ से थोड़ा सा मदद करूंगा कि जो आपका हक बनता है वो आपको जगह हम नहीं दे पाए, लेकिन इंशाल्लाह इस वेबिनार की तरह से भी हम ये कोशिश करेंगे, और जहाँ तक हो सका हम पूरा ये जहाँ जहाँ मौका मिला, मैं मीडिया पर भी आता रहता हूँ, मेरी मुलाकात गवर्नमेंट ऑफिशियल से होती रहती है, आपको आपका सही मकाम दिलवाएंगे, और आप भी इंशाल्लाह मुझे यकीन है कि अल्लाह ताला के फजल व करम से पाकिस्तान की तरक्की में, हमें खुराक के सिलसिले में खुद कफील बनाने में हमारी मदद करते रहेंगे। तो मेरा ख्याल है कि जो हमारे पहले स्पीकर हैं डॉक्टर शौकत अली, वो तो मौजूद नहीं है, जब तक वो हमें ज्वाइन करते हैं मैं इस्तदा करूंगा डॉक्टर सैयद जावेद खुर्शीद साहब से कि वो अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन से मिले। डॉक्टर शौकत अली साहब से शुरू करते हैं, और इनका तारफ करवा दिया गया है। डॉक्टर साहब, ओवर टू यू, आप शुरू कीजिए अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन प्लीज। थैंक यू।
in a condition.
Doshak sir.
जी डॉक्टर शौकत साहब आप मुझे सुन पा रहे हैं?
Yes, नहीं मेरा ख्याल जी I'm trying to connect sir.
Okay. So if you want to take some time, if you allow, we can go to our next speaker and then you can connect and we can take you as the second speaker. Is it okay?
Yes.
चलो ठीक है ऐसे करते हैं. चले जी जैसे हम पहले कहा था कि डॉक्टर सैयद जावेद खुर्शीद साहब आप काइंडली सर अपना प्रेजेंटेशन दे दीजिए और फिर इतने में डॉक्टर शौकत अली कनेक्ट कर लेंगे फिर हम वापस उनके पास चले जाएंगे. बहुत शुक्रिया डॉक्टर जावेद खुर्शीद साहब. डॉक्टर साहब की स्लाइडें चलाएं भाई
इनके पास नहीं
स्क्रीन कर लो ना
डॉक्टर साहब आपके पास स्क्रीन शेयर राइट्स हैं आप ऑन कर सकते हैं.
ओके फाइन आई एम डूइंग इट. क्या हुआ? ओके लेट द पर्सन कम हु इज गोइंग टू डिस्प्ले द थिंग्स. आई एम वेरी हैप्पी दैट आई हैव बीन इनवाइटेड टू दिस सेमिनार and to speak on this. As already Janal sir said, this is a very important topic, and beside that it is a very unique topic in a sense that see if you see the topic, always people are talking about the climate change effects on the agriculture, but this topic is really different, and this topic is giving a sense that how the agriculture biotechnology is going to affect the climate change. And today's topic is not as usual, the climate change effects on the agriculture, but it is the other way around. The agriculture biotechnology affects on climate change. And I will try to provide the background information about the role of green biotechnology currently playing and how it can play its role in future in helping the mitigation of the climate change. So I will try to give the information. I will try to give the theme that what we are trying to reduce and what we want to mitigate and how it's going to affect. Global climate change actually, in general, when you see it, besides seeing a lot of effects it has, it is the global warming. What I mean by that is the earth average temperature increase, surface temperature due to effect of greenhouse gases. That greenhouse gases is affecting. And what is that effect? Actually, when sunlight comes to the earth, when there are green lights, they trap the heat and trap the energy going back to the atmosphere, and that heat energy really warms the surface of the earth, and then the temperature rises. This is the main effect which is causing the basic problem. Okay, what are those effects and how they affect the earth? Rise of temperature really happens, melting of ice results in the sea level, changes in precipitation patterns, effects of organisms, effect of human health, and effects on agriculture. But I'm going to deal with the causes of global climate change. What is really causing that global climate change and how we can deal with it? Okay, now let me talk about what are the greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases are the carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, sulfur hexafluorides. Okay, what really happens? Average of global temperature climbed in the last 20 years from 0.6 degree centigrade. Arctic sea ice 40% is thinner than the last 50 years. Alpine glaciers are retreating, ocean acidification taking place, sea level has risen, changes in animal behavior, breeding cycles, storm frequency and intensity are increasing. We have to mitigate that effects. These are the effects. Okay, climate change threatens all elements such as water, food, environment, and land. This is a dramatic scenario whose most obvious symptoms would be the change in weather conditions, such as more heat waves, more storms, floods caused by melting of glaciers. Now, actually, how it is affecting the humans and from where these effects are coming. We see in this global warming, agriculture is giving portion of agriculture is nearly 13%. Deforestation is 14%. Industrial process is 24%. And burning of fossil fuels is 49%. But what is the main thing which is affecting this global warming? If we see, the carbon dioxide is nearly 64% of all the greenhouse gases which is affecting. Then methane is 19%. Chlorofluorocarbons is 11%. So basically, we have to think about the carbon dioxide. Mainly, the process of global warming is taking place by the carbon dioxide percentage. Now, what we have to avoid and how we can avoid? Actually, the world figures are that we have to stabilize carbon dioxide level in the world from 550 up to 550 ppm. Now here in 2021, we have reached to 410 ppm. Now 2050, it is estimated that we can reach to 620 ppm. And in 21,000, we can reach from 600 to 1,000 ppm. So actually we have to stabilize our atmosphere or the worldwide should be not increased from the 550 ppm. Now, the focus should be on mitigation. Focus is on limiting greenhouse gases emission, moderate global climate change, especially from the carbon dioxide point of view. Now, if we look at the things what Jarnal Sahib has talked about, the food security and food requirement. If we see the SDGs and how the world population is increasing and what with the world population on 2050, nearly, you can see it will be nearly double. So we have to save our food and we have to save our environment. These are the two basic things which I have shown in yellow. There are other things which are not directly affected, but right now they are affected, but right now I'm talking about the food and environment. So I will discuss the food and environment. So for survival, human being, we need food, and at the same time, we have to prevent climate change. There are many answers to it, like nuclear technology, getting energy from the solar sides, getting energy from the hydro side and everything. But one of the portion which I'm going to speak today is one of the many answers can get from the agriculture biotechnology. And how this agriculture biotechnology is helping us, let me discuss that. Okay, contribution of agriculture biotechnology. First thing is production and increase yield, because as I have shown you, and the world population is increasing and we have to provide the food safety. So the major role played by the agriculture biotechnology is to enhance agriculture productivity, maximize production capacity, and diminishing the resources which we use and affect the climate change. Okay, now the contribution of agriculture biotechnology. The main one I have already talked, and other two main contributions are the greenhouse gas reduction and crop adaptation. Now, greenhouse reduction, gas reduction, how we can do it by agriculture, by biotechnology. Green biotechnology offers solutions to the offer solutions to decrease greenhouse gases emission and help mitigate climate change by offering the tools of important and engineered crops using less energy through increase in yield. Require few pesticide sprays, because agriculture, the biotechnology develops those crops which need less pesticide spray. Okay. Second, they require less tracer use of tractor use, less carbon dioxide emission. You will be amazed to know that the plowing, which we reduced by introducing those crops, by tractor use, we reduced 24 billion of kilogram of carbon dioxide. It is really amazing that how much tractor use we can save from the agriculture biotechnology crops. Second, then we can develop biofertilizers, and also by providing biofertilizers, we can save the inorganic fertilizers which we put in the environment. And third, then they save the crops which are developed by the agriculture biotechnology use biopesticides, and they use very less pesticides. And in that case also, we reduce the use of the pesticides. Third, we reduce the herbicides. Like if we consider the crop of soybean, canola, they facilitate zero-till. And then we have to, again, use less tractor time and less fuel, fossil fuel. Reduce of loss of soil, carbon dioxide emissions, and soil erosion can be saved. Third, by adopting these agriculture biotechnology crops, that could help farmers facing all these challenges which I have talked. This is absolutely essential for farmers in developing countries as well as in some developed countries where yield would be affected substantially. Genetic modification and hybridization is being used for this purpose. The induction of nodular structure in the roots of the crops reduce the use of nitrogen and decrease it. It will be decrease the usage of inorganic fertilizer also beside that. So we will be saving the environment by the inorganic fertilizer. Third, utilization of excess carbon dioxide in the air by the stable crops, cereal crops, is also one of the important thing, that it uses carbon dioxide in the atmosphere for the cereal crops. Maize can also efficiently assimilate to convert carbon dioxide to carbon product during photosynthesis. This is one of the things which we can produce by the agriculture biotechnology. Then the last, insect resistance in the biotech crop. When introduced in the biotech crop, use less pesticide sprays, less tractor usage, less fossil fuels, and less carbon dioxide. Now, what the worldwide effect it is creating? Green biotechnology, due to its benefits, has been adopted by 29 countries in the world. And 129 million of hectares worldwide is under cultivation of agriculture biotech crops, mainly soybean, maize, canola, and cotton. Then 5 countries are mainly handling the agriculture biotech crop in the 90% of their crop areas, like namely US, Brazil, Argentina, Canada, and India. Now, recent climate change in Pakistan. Pakistan, we have seen the rise of temperature 0.6 to 0.8 degrees centigrade in the coastal areas. Approximately 2,000 people lose their lives every year in Pakistan due to dehydration and heat strokes. Nearly 0 to 7% solar radiation over southern hemisphere of the country. 3 to 5% decrease in cloud cover in the central Pakistan. 5% increase in net irrigation water requirement, and 10 to 15% decrease in both winter and summer rainfall in the belt of plains of Pakistan. 18 to 32% increase in rainfall in monsoon zones, especially in the subhumid and humid areas, expanding aridity in northern parts outside the monsoon rain. So frequency of depressions and cyclones increased over Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea during last 70 years. So we will be saving these things, and agriculture biotech crops will be helping us in less water resources, agriculture and food security, forestry and land use change. This will be the effect when we use the agriculture biotechnology. Now, Pakistan's achievement in agriculture biotechnology is in practice in Pakistan for last 25 years. See, in 1994, we got the approval of NIBGE, National Institute of Biotechnology and Engineering, and in 94 and 96 started working. So it is really contributing in our agriculture biotechnology achievements, contributing in reduction of carbon dioxide emission, allowing farmers to use less fertilizer and remove practices for the carbon dioxide. About 32 institutes of biotechnology are working in Pakistan. Namely, the big institutes which are contributing is NIBGE, CAP, PEBI, and National Institute of Center of Molecular Biology, and there is one institute in HEJ which is really contributing towards our agriculture biotechnology side in this field. NIBGE, mainly, I have been directing the NIBGE, and I know it is working very efficiently and has developed many transgenic lines of cotton, wheat, sugarcane, and potato. But still, we are unable to provide these crops in the journal cultivation procedures. Conclusion, the green biotechnology is so useful, virtually every farmer can use it. Agriculture biotechnology, besides increasing the yield of the less in the less time, enables to mitigate climate change by the innovation in the usage of resources. Thank you so much for giving me the time. I have given an overview of what is happening in Pakistan as agriculture biotechnology is considered.
Thank you very much, Dr. Javed Khurshid Saab. It was a pleasure listening to you. You covered the very important aspects of greenhouse effect and its adverse effects on human life. Then how to mitigate it. You said that green biotechnology is the answer. It saves engine emissions of tractors because you need less of tilling probably. It reduces use of chemicals, both in fertilizers and also the sprays that we use. More yield, and it also saves water. So very good overview of everything, and a positive impact on environment because of all the effects. Thank you very much, sir. We'll see if there'll be any questions. We'll wait for some time and we'll ask you to answer those questions. So if Dr. Shaukat Saab, Shaukat Ali is ready, sir, are you all right now? Are you online? Can we?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shaukat. So he will be talking to us on current dynamics of agri-biotech in Pakistan. Over to you, Dr. Saab.
Thank you, sir. So this is we talk about the current developments in the agriculture biotechnology field of Pakistan. So next, please. So the journey started with the first tissue culture in the 1970s. We see the conventional biotechnology tissue culture. And then later on in the following years, I mean, in the 80s decade, the developments on occurred on modern biotechnology with the conduct of some capacity building trainings. And then in following in the same decade, in 1983 to 4, we see the first biotech, modern biotech institute, Center of Excellence for Molecular Biology at, located at University of Punjab, Lahore. And later in the same decade, we see the establishment of NIBJI, and also we see some initiatives on biotechnology at National Agriculture Research Center, Islamabad. Then in the following years, next please. We see the development on the, in the in mid of 80s, the it is era where we started the development of transgenic or genetically modified crop vaccin. Pakistan fortunately initiated well in the, we have seen in the 90s, CAM, Center of Excellence for Molecular Biology, Lahore, and NIBJI, they started work, CAM work started on rice. And then in the early 90s, we see the destruction of many cotton leaf curl virus, where agricultural biotechnology played a great role in the identification of the virus races and other things. Then in the 2000, we see the establishment of Higher Education Commission resulted in a number of institutes development, in the, especially in the academic sector that started work on agricultural biotechnology. Then in the 2007, state of the art agri institute, I mean, National for Genomics and Advanced Biotechnology, NIGAB, actually, NIGAB, Islamabad, NARC. So with the advent following, we see first in 2010, the commercial release of first transgenic genetically modified crop cotton in Pakistan, that was for insect resistance. And then in the following years, we see the commercialization trials of genetically modified corn. Next, please. So so far, we see the network of these institutes, including the major institutes, NIBJI, CAM, NIGAB, and other institutes. We see the, in the academic sector, different institutes that mainly supported by the Higher Education Commission. So it's number around 45 so far, including the all the University Institute, including CAP and CAS at University of Agriculture, Faisalabad, and other, IBJI is the at the University of Agriculture, Peshawar, and other institutes. Next, please. So this is our major biotech institutes, which have their specified and mandated areas. I see CAM is on health, agriculture, and the NIBJI is on plant, health, environment. HEJ, Karachi, Hussain Ibrahim Jamal Research Institute, Karachi, and KIBJI, and then NIGAB, which I mentioned earlier, 2007. So this is one of the exclusive institutes in agriculture that is focusing on plant and animal biotechnology simultaneously. Next, please. So this is our areas, which in my opinion, the whatever field of or whatever our technology of biotechnology is there, this is the areas and traits where biotechnology actually can complement the agriculture of Pakistan. We need biotech innovations and interventions in cotton, we see, and because all these traits which I mentioned here, these are poorly or very difficult to address by conventional means of the plant improvement. So it is the role of biotech techniques, whether it is transgenics or whether the marker system, DNA tools. So biotechnology can really make a breakthrough through the improvement of the resistance for these different biotech and abiotic tests in Pakistan. Yes, please. So this is a current scenario, sir, where what is going on so far in the Pakistan Agriculture Biotech Institute, which I mentioned earlier, is a general picture. We see the crops of groundnut, which is right now under some are different status. Some are experimental stage, and some crops are at the field stage, and some crop like cotton is at the commercialization. Cotton is the only so far crops which have been genetically modified cotton is commercialized in Pakistan. All other crops we see, groundnut, herbicide resistance. This is all of work which have been given approvals by the National Biosafety Center of Pakistan for different traits and different crops. And this is the current status in groundnut, maize, cotton. Cotton is the major crop that has been so far targeted by for the improvement through the biotech tools in Pakistan. Other crops are the brassica and potato is for the effort distance, which will trade. Next, please. Then we see the wheat for the different abiotics tests. The sugarcane is for these. Right now, it is have been given approval for field trials. And chickpea and tomato, these are also, tomato is the first genetically modified crop in vegetables in Pakistan that have been given approval very recently in 2021 for field trials. Hopefully we see this crop in future at the commercialization stage very soon. Next, please. So these are different institutes, which are different crops. Mainly they are focusing mainly 4 or 5 institutes, which I mentioned earlier in my list. So these are different crops. They have so far working NIBGI and CAM, NIGAP, and major institutes that have been playing role and working on this movement, these crops. Next, please. So far, sir, the current scenario, what's the development? Only I mentioned the cotton has the success at a commercial GM crops in Pakistan. Currently, we see the 90% area under genetically modified cotton varieties in Pakistan. So this is the 9th largest area in the world regarding the GM crops. So far, 3 genetic events, they are the ownership events that have been released in Pakistan. One is by the Monsanto 531. Actually, this was by Monsanto. And other we see a good development in Pakistan. Our CAM has recently in 2021 they have given two local genetically modified events for cotton in Pakistan. That is CAM2. It is for double gene, double BT gene, and GTG. This is for herbicide tolerant genes. So right now, these crops have been commercially released by the Punjab Seed Council, and we see these crops, even our local events in the field. Unfortunately, sir, transgenic maize, completed all the regulatory channels. It was given actually even for the commercialization license, but we could not see the commercial release on ground of this field. So this has been still subjected to the government policy, actually, whether we need transgenic maize or not. So it's still pending and in the court of government, what decision regarding transgenic maize has to be made. But so far it is in the pending, and only cotton is the commercial crops, which we see in the field. Next, please. So this is a new area which is world is now focusing other than because the transgenics or genetically modified crops have some is regulatory issues and acceptability issues across the world. And also we see the extensive regulatory requirements for the release of the transgenic crops, which it takes long time compared to the normal conventional varieties. So these are the regulatory issues which are hurdling and rather extensive regulatory issue which are hurdling the release and to harvest the benefits of this technology. So this technology now has been transformed into a new area which we call as genome editing. So this is relatively a new area. Next, please. So actually genome editing, next, please, is a combination and blend of the earlier techniques. We see the conventional breeding in 1950s and 80s is mutagenesis. Last slide, please. See last slide. So it's genome editing as a blend of the earlier, the conventional breeding, where we see the simple crossing of two parents and same slide, ma'am. Last. So I mean, this is the technology, genome editing is a reality blend of the earlier techniques. And then we see, please stay on, please, please. Last slide.
Sir, previous or last?
आगे वाली वो कह रहे हैं शायद
आप previous
कह रहे हैं sir.
Yes.
Previous.
This one, sir. Tomatoes.
इसे पहले ये so it's a new breeding method which is a relatively more predictable because through conventional breeding and the it's not predictable. Lot of undesirable genes they get into the even the other the next generation. And then we see in the 80s era, we see the genetic modification, that is the transgenesis and cisgenesis area, which is the development of the genetically modified crops. So this is, as I mentioned earlier, has some extensive regulatory issues and other things, but we see the more refined and predictable, precise, faster techniques is the genome editing. These genetic changes in the genome edited, I mean, plants or, you know, are maybe seen. There are three kinds of changes, maybe which we called as SDN1, SDN2, and SDN3. So this is very important to mention these three changes because all the world regulatory issues regarding the acceptability of G crops are centered around these three changes, 1, 2, and 3. So the countries are making decisions because in SDN1 and 1, this is just like normal change. And in SDN2, we see some insertion of relatively short sequence of DNA, but it is not transcribed into some protein. But in SDN3, we see some relatively longer sequence. So these are three parameters which the countries at the international level considered as case by cases for the regulation of these GE crops. Next thing. Next slide. Next slide. So data technology is playing a role. Fortunately, Pakistani institutes, they have started, but still very at preliminary stage. They have started work, but at to date, we know we see the commercial release of GE crops. We see in Japan, biofortified tomato this year, and in US, we see the commercialization of genetically GE for herbicide tolerant canola. Also, there are different crops right now. These are under research still at different entities, architecture for root length and flowering. Cotton is like Nipji and Cam is undertaking. Then tomato and potato is under NIGAB and NIPG. So we may see it's a good news. At least there is a capacity building. The potential is there. At least the manpower is there. And which we see in the future, hopefully the commercial release of these crops in Pakistan. The next, please. Next. So next. So this is a new basically next. So this is a new basically area which is the development of green super rice in Pakistan, which have National Agriculture Center in NIGAB had started with the collaboration of Chinese National China Academy of Agriculture Sciences. So this rice has is basically environment friendly. It uses highly nutrient efficient and also it is tolerant to stresses. So, and it is basically non-basmati rice with long, extra long grain and long grain length. And so this is developed have been in the collaboration with the Chinese Academy of Agriculture through the genomic selection through a new breeding technique, what we call as genome-based breeding. So it's a good potential. And hopefully in other institutes also may take this kind of genome-based breeding and it has good potential. So we will see in very near future the release of green super rice varieties with extra and extra long grain in Pakistan. The next one. So this is also a very recent development in Pakistan also. which we see because it's you know era of sequencing and next generation sequencing era. This is a new machine, which is a T7 next generation platform, which is the first kind of platform even in Southeast Asia, which Pakistan has acquired recently by at National Agriculture Research Center in Pakistan. And this is had multiple applications. Right now, this system has started work, and hopefully it will facilitate the national agricultural biotechnology system and our scientists regarding the genomic selection of plants, livestock, and then DNA fingerprinting, because this is a very now emerging in the era of this century. It's the era of regulations. Intellectual property rights have become very important. So it is very important to protect our national agriculture assets based on DNA fingerprinting. So this platform will greatly facilitate and then discovery of new genes and then determination of the off-target effects while we do the genome editing technique, which we, as I mentioned earlier, there is a problem. So this, this facility and this platform will avoid to those off-target toxicity effects. So it's a good development, sir. And hopefully this will have good future in Pakistan. And the next, please. Next. So now I will talk to some regulations, what we know of, because this is very important when we talk about the modern biotechnology. So this is the basic two agreements, the CBD, Center of Biodiversity, that was signed by the nations in 1992. And that led to the development of Tata Genome Protocol on biosafety in 2003. So this protocol basically is handles the transboundary movement of genetically modified crops and biosafety. Next, please. Pakistan has signed these two agreements as member of this CBB, Tata Genome Protocol on biosafety. We signed in 2002, but unfortunately, we took a long time to ratify this protocol. In 2009, we ratified this protocol. Next, please. So based on this this protocol, we have our Pakistan Biosafety Rules 2005 actually. So these rules, they regulate the laboratory work, field work, and commercial use of developed living modified or genetically modified plants. And it's also all regulate the import, export, sale, other related activities for that are meant for commercial purpose. So next, please. So this this is the three the mechanism, the implementation of the rules, three tier mechanism, the Institutional Biosafety Committee and Technical Advisory Committee and National Biosafety Committee. So this is our national active system. National Biosafety Committee is based at Islamabad under the Ministry of Planetary Ministry on Climate Change. And then we see the Technical Advisory is the middle body between the two. So these three bodies, they grant in the sequence permission for three separate levels. First, we have to get permission for laboratory work. Then it led to the field trials, and then followed by the commercial release. Next, please. So this is some activities related to the plant tissue. Although this is a very not modern biotech, but it is still working for some crops. Some recent developments in the history of Pakistan, two banana varieties, that is Nagab 1 and Nagab 2, they have been released this year by the same Sindh Council. So it's a good development. These varieties have good potential, longer shelf life, and compared to higher yield over to local Basrai or dwarf Cavendish varieties, which was in cultivation by the banana farmers since 1947. So these new varieties, Nagab 1 and Nagab 2, they are now rapidly replacing the banana area in Sindh. About 10,000 acres currently is covered by these two varieties. And hopefully in future, we'll see the release with commercial export of these banana, because they have relatively longer shelf life compared to the 4 to 5 weeks compared to Dwarco and Cavendish. Next, please. So this is an activity regarding potato tissue culture, because Pakistan is totally dependent upon the import of about 15,000 tons in annual import potato seed from mainly from Netherlands. So this is a need of time. Currently, we have started this activity with the private-public partnership, and every year we are producing now, since last year, 50,000 mini tubers. So hopefully in next, if this activity is sustained and continued in next 2 to 5 years, we will see our considerable reduction in the potato seed import of high quality. Next, please. Next. So this is our activity, just I mentioned earlier, with the, so this is my last slide. What we need, what are the issues and hurdles? So mainly of these are the regulatory in nature. As I mentioned earlier, that we now see the genetically edited crops. Our national biosafety rules have been developed and approved in 2005. So since last 15 years, there have been a lot of new developments in the world, and there is need to revisit our national biosafety rules, which we have not done so far. Likely, we are facing the problem of genetically modified soybean. Currently, this issue is very hot, and because our poultry industry feed and other is dependent on GM soybean. So, unfortunately, we don't have it's all unchecked import of genetically modified soybean, and maybe canola is there. And we have rules, but we have not been able to set rules SOPs. And for the import, National Ministry of Climate Change, sir, recently is constituted a committee. Even I myself was included in that committee. We have designed the SOPs since last 6 months, but still pending and not implemented. And likewise, we have no regulations for GE crops, but every country has own decisions for genetically edited crops. So we have not decided so far what we have to do. Either we have to accept the SDN1, either we have SDN2, or accept all the SDN3. Regarding intellectual property rights, there is rules are there, bodies are there, but unfortunately the implementation and infringement is very weak. So that is why it is discouraging the people to have even the investors, foreign investors, or the companies or the to have that technology in the field. Our national biosafety system is need to strengthen. We see the establishment of National Biosafety Center in 2009 or 10, but it was a project-based PSDB funded. After the end of those projects, our National Biosafety Center has no even permanent office and permanent staff, and even no permanent source of funding. So this is need to be regularized. If we have some National Biosafety Authority, like other authorities, OGRA or PEMRA, so it should have a strong base, permanent staff, and its own monitoring system. So one of the issue is in our biotech system, sir, is the lack of coordination of among our national biotech institutes. There is a lot of duplication in the work. Many institutes working on the same objective, same rules, even having different source of funding. So link this with problems, we need a national biotechnology policy, which is lacking in Pakistan. National Biotechnology Commission, one was project-based, institute was established in early 2002 to 2005. But it started work and developed some documents on the national biotech policy, but unfortunately those works could not be continued and sustained. And since to date, we don't have any national biotechnology policy where we can prioritize our activities, our crops, our target traits. So this is a very important which need to be have to be initiated at government level. Next. So this is the father of green revolution. Even he foresee the potential of this technology. And it is the now the our major tool where we can meet our food security and other requirements. So that's also.
Bahut shukriya, Dr. Shaukat Saab. Thank you very much. It was very interesting. I was pleasantly surprised to know that we have so many institutions, those who are working on the research of our agriculture thing.
Thank you very much, sir.
Heartening to know that we have such qualified people around. We didn't know that. Then you have done a lot, you people, for the research is concerned, development of advanced varieties. I also understood that it's a highly regulated area. So I think in the question answer session, there's a lot of questions which will be asked from you, that in spite of having such elaborate arrangements, why are we not having the results which we should be having? And you have of course, indicated certain areas. We'll ask you later on. Thank you, Dr. Saab. Now for the last speaker, request Dr. Yusuf Zafar Saab. He will be talking to us the application of nuclear technology to enhance our agriculture output. Dr. Saab, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Ji, please go ahead, sir.
I think I will get the permission for sharing the screen. Right. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, I'm really grateful to SVI for giving me this opportunity. I have worked in agriculture and life sciences and one of the pioneers of biotechnology, agriculture biotechnology in the country. But the topic today given to me is the peaceful uses of nuclear technology for enhanced agriculture output. Because I served for 36 years in Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission. I will talk on generally first, what is because I thought that some people will talk on, you know, what is the relevance of agriculture to our economy, what is the global agenda in terms of food security, what we are doing in the national context, and what is the nuclear technology or mutagenesis, what they call, or irradiation, they are contributing in the food and agriculture sector, and what Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission achieved in this sector. So the first is agriculture. As we know, this agriculture promotes food security. That is number one thing. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are listening to you.
You are listening to us. Okay. Because I thought that whether there is some problem of... Yeah. Yes. So what I'm talking is the agriculture, we know, promotes food security. This is the very cardinal point, and these are non-traditional securities now. You need a health security, you need environment security, you need water security. So it's not only the traditional strategic security which is important for a country to progress. It is the, you know, the food security is very, very vital. We have seen the collapse of Soviet Union. Among other things, the state was unable to provide, you know, the food security. Everybody was standing in a queue, in some queue of the eggs or for a pork or for some bread, you know. So the second, in Pakistan, whatever we have limited export, so one, we are direct exports of rice is around $2.2 billion last year. The livestock, which is leather and the meat and fruit and vegetables, and whatever small industry we have like textile, sugarcane and poultry, as the General Saab has very rightly said, poultry for the last 10 years, last decade, is growing in a double digit. We have 16 billion eggs and around 2 billion kgs of poultry meat, and providing the protein, which is very essential to get rid of malnutrition. So it is now almost equal to our sugar industry, and it is 1700 billion rupees investment by the private sector. So it is the raw material for all these industries coming from agriculture. And then we know, despite our, you know, we always complain about the extension in the urban area, but our rural population in the recent census of 2017 simply reduced from 64% to 62%. So the area has increased, the rural, the urban area, but the rural population remained with the in the villages.
Excuse me, sir. Press F5. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now seen presentation view.
Yes, that agriculture, as you know, I mean, I always say that agriculture, you know, like religion, like politics, everybody poke his or her nose because they think that because we are eating chapati or roti or salan, so we know agriculture. But agriculture is a very complex affair. Once the agriculture subsidy was discussed in the U.S. Capitol Hill, and at that time, way back in 1950s, by Eisenhower said, the agriculture looks simpler for only those who are 1,000 miles away from the field, and whose plow is a pencil, and whose field is a file. So for them, they look very simple. But otherwise, we know that there are so many, you know, it is the only commodity which you cannot take off the shelf. The best cotton, like Pima cotton of the US, is a total failure in Pakistan because of the soil, water, and environment is different. But if you take a Mercedes or F-16, you have the same comfort or same advantages, whether you are using it in America or Somalia or in Pakistan. So agriculture, you cannot take off the shelf. So there is a major shift in WTO because of it is a now no more public good. It is a tradable commodity. So there was earlier a vital role of public sector, and it has also been affected by the climate change. So General Saab has talked about, you know, self-sufficiency or khud kafalat, jo it was very common notion in the beginning. But now people are talking food security, that it is not the food which should be well, it must be nutritious. If you are taking a milk and it is not pasteurized, instead of giving you benefit, it can cause you dysentery. So people have added with the evolutionary process, they understood. So they have changed the food security, self-sufficiency from food security, and that is availability to everyone all the time, the nutritious food. And under that, you know, it is availability, accessibility, trade and storage, and then safety. So it's become a very good. So green revolution came in 60s, but it was a very, you know, input intensive in terms of fertilizer, in terms of pesticides, in terms of water, in terms of machinery. But now people are talking, they understood in 1980, as in Sayyid Javed Khurshid discussed about the climate change. So people realize this thing, and now they are asking for an evergreen revolution. And Shaukat also talked about the biotechnology, which is one of the contributor to, you know, the better crops or evergreen revolution. And nuclear technology is also contributing in that direction. So the globally, people have understood that thing. And in 2000, in the start of the next century, so wo jo bada mashhoor tha ke ji nayi sadi aa rahi hai in late 90s mein, to us zamane mein Zameer Jafri kaha karte the ki agar hum galti se nayi sadi ke darwaze pe pahunch bhi gaye to maybe hame jo na lathi charge karke wapas bhej diya jaye. तो मिलेनियम डेवलपमेंट गोल ग्लोबल एजेंडा बना 2000-2015 में, एंड द सेवंथ गोल इन द एट दैट टाइम वाज यू नो इंश्योर ऑफ एनवायरनमेंट एंड सूटेबिलिटी. लेकिन उसमें पहली में था इरेडिकेशन पॉवर्टी एंड हंगर. तो हंगर और को इरेडिकेशन कहा गया, रिमूव जीरो हंगर नहीं कहा गया. So people realize this thing, that the MDGs were unable to make an impact. Usme non-communicable disease were also not included. So sustainable development goal developed in the Rio agenda, plus Rio agenda in 2015-2030, which is in voyage. And in this, if you go to goal number two, it is zero hunger. That's mean the people, the global community, the citizenry and leadership, they decided that the in 2020, nobody of the 9 billion people will ever sleep without food in the night. So if you go you know, in detail, the true number is zero hunger. but it relates to number 1 and number 14 and number 15 and number 17. So 8 out of 17, 18 goals, they are directly related to agriculture. So what is food security? Food exists when we have sufficient, safe and nutritious food available to us. This is the general definition by the World Food Summit in 1986 by FAO. So it is replaced the self-sufficiency concept. Singapore is a food square country because they have the purchasing power, they can have a regulation to have a safe, nutritious food available to all the citizens all the time, even in crises like floods or drought or something. But Pakistan, despite agriculture country, has a very low, you know, in hunger index because our systems are not, you know, in line with the food security. So this, you one must understand this thing, that the merely self-sufficiency is not enough. If you, even you have a sugar with you, but you are unable to supply the chain and control the hoardings and other mafias and cartels, and your citizenry is standing in a queue to get 1 kg, that means you are not food square country. What are the challenges? General challenges are the population increasing. Among the SAR countries, we are the highest in terms of population growth. You know, at the time of Bangladesh, 1971, they were more than us. Now they are 160 million, we are 220 million. So with this, when you have increased about, you have more mouths to feed. So therefore, you know, you have a more strains or burden on your limited resources of land, water, and air. So your water availability has reduced from surplus at 7,400 cubic meter to nearly 1,000. That means from surplus to scarce. Your land availability has reduced from 7.7 hectare to 0.4 and now even 0.27. So it is decreasing at a very drastic rate. And similarly, all other input cost is increasing, like fertilizer, pesticides, and transportation. So this is one example how from surplus to scarce, how we have gone, you know, only and only due to mismanagement and bad, management of our resources, which is very precious. We have three rivers and then dams and 10,000 canals. But despite that, we are facing the serious problem, you know, of the water. So coming to the nuclear side, you know, we were very fortunate that the Pakistan Atomic Energy Commission came into being in 1957. At the same time, the UN multilateral body, you know, International Atomic Energy Agency at Vienna came in 1957. And basically, it was the idea Atom for Peace by President Eisenhower. And he said after, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945, that they have always atom or nuclear technology is linked with the strategic, or defense or bombs like things. So they said we can use atom for peace and we can use atom for water, resources management, for agriculture, for health, for cancer treatment, for radiation purposes, for food safety. And for so many other things, you know, one can use. So based on that, they made IAEA in Vienna. The Austria offered us place. So you can see the buildings. There are 163 member states who are the full-fledged member. They have a board of governor. Pakistan is alternatively about 18 times remained on the board of governor. There are from about 120 countries, there are more than 2,000 professional staff. And 2 scientific laboratories, one in Cyberdorf outside the Vienna, 35 kilometer, and other marine biology labs in Malta. And their budget is given, but they have technical cooperation fund, it is extra budgetary, which is 75 million, you know. So they have 6 department. We always think of the nuclear in with the energy. This is another peaceful use of making electricity. Pakistan has five plants in operation. 4 at Chashma and 1 is in Karachi, and the nuclear science and application in food, agriculture, nuclear safety, safeguard and management technical. They are working on human health, food and agriculture, water, nuclear energy, safety and security. And they are working on crop production, insect pest control, livestock production, especially zoonotic disease, like Ebola, like MERS, like bird flu, and now with the COVID. We know that all these diseases, which became pandemic or epidemic, they came from animal. Those are the animal is the first source which from which it jumps to the human and adapted to that. You know. So they are working on the first line of action that they are want to control on the animal, you know, livestock thing through the nuclear technology. And food safety and quality is another issue where their nuclear technology is working. So they are working in the water, in fresh water, oceans and land. So, we know irradiation, they have different type of radiations, how you can use it for electron, X-rays, gamma rays, beta rays and others. And how they affect the microwave, which are normally used, you know, now for heating purpose, they are also part of the radiation. Food irradiation is the process by which food products are exposed to a controlled amount of radiant energy for the safety of food and to extend the shelf life. So people are using since 1960 in USA, as well as in Japan, advanced countries. Like I have seen a factory in China, they have a huge, ye jo murgi ki tange hain, jo iske panje karte hain, they are using like a lollipop in China. Every metro store, every petrol pump, gas station, you get them. So because there are a lot of contamination, they go through radiation and the large scale about, 3 lakh ton per year, they go for radiation and they are eating it, every Chinese is using, as a snack. Similarly, in Japan, which is another advanced country, the potato, as you know, if you are placing at home for a longer period of time, they start sprouting. Similarly with onion and with garlic and with others. So people are using radiation to stop that effect and increase the shelf life and so that the farmers can get more profitability out of this fresh perishable project. So what Pakistan did in that thing, you know, we have a marvelous, I will say, very success story of 65 years of journey in the field of peaceful duty. I always contribute, say that, you know, our Vijay leadership in 60s, in early 50s and 60s was so, powerful visionary people that at that time they started, you know, we were the, in 1970 in Karachi, Canoop started, even China or South Korea didn't have a nuclear power plant when we have already started in Asia, for that matter, you know. So our vigil leadership started the peaceful use of nuclear technology in health and in agriculture. So the first in Tandojam in remote area of Sindh and nuclear medical center in Jam Shoro was started construction in 1958. And President Ayub Khan and King Hussein of Jordan, they visited those places, you know, at that time. And Naya Tandojam started working. Every 10 years, Atomic Energy Commission made new center, one in first in Faisalabad after 10 years, then after 10 years in Peshawar, and then after 10 years and a biotechnology and genetic institute in Faisalabad. Unfortunately, we don't have any institute in Balochistan. It must be there with General Lodhi Saab. We request that this is a missing point, that in the all four provinces, we must have a nuclear center. Like we have a medical center in all Pakistan, including AJK and also at Gilgit-Baltistan. So in Paras, we have a commercial center where we radiate mango, kinus, and as you said, the medicine of like ophthalmology and the gloves and the plastic latex things, you know, there is a big center of Atomic Commission in Lahore, they called Paras, and they are doing serving the nation, I mean, quietly in a big manner, you know. So, because we are dealing with agriculture today, Pakistan Army Commission, though very small people, I mean, 260 PhD scientists in 4 centers, one of the highest ratio of the PhD scientists in the atomic energy centers. For example, we have 57 scientists in NIPJI, and out of that are almost 40 are PhDs. So we have very high ratio, and including the gender balance, you know, out of 55 scientists in NIPJI, 17 are ladies who are lady scientists who are MPhil or PhD in their respective subjects. We have working on wheat, rice, canola, chickpea, mung bean, lentil, sesame. Sesame is a, जिसको हम तिल कहते हैं, is a wonderful crop. Last year our export was about 45 million US dollar because this is very sort of commodity in Middle East and China. And castor also used in aviation industries, oil, lubricant, sugarcane, banana. Castor has a problem of the spines, so Nayab by radiation developed the variety which has no spine and it is easy to harvest in Thar area and in lot of area has been covered by castor oil. So it's also a silent contribution by the our agriculture scientists in Atomic Energy Commission. Sugarcane, Naya and banana, we are also working in that, and soybean is a new emerging crop. And NIPG has started work by getting all the lines and not to be dependent on US for this thing. I have just narrated few success stories. It is very, you know, relevant, although it's a very large, I mean, stories, but I have selected only three or four to convince our audience that how even a small group, when it is focused, when it is working on a with a lot of dedication and commitment, how they make a change. Say, one take one variety of cotton, Nayab 78. You know, they developed the variety. In general, Zia came to our center twice. It's a very small center in Faisalabad, in remote area. But, you know, the president himself came because Dr. Mehbubulak told him that earlier we have a 40 lakh bales of cotton. By this variety, is a well-adapted and more productivity. We have at that time starting making 70 lakh of bales of cotton. From 4 million, we reached 7 million. He explained to the president that it has brought quietly the white revolution in the country and brought 4 billion in the economy of the GDP of the country. It covered 70% area and it remained 70 years in the field unless the virus came in 1992 and then we have a problem. Take one example. Last year, I was giving a talk to our Honorable Prime Minister, and he told, sir, this is a matter of concern that we are importing 1.2 billion, billion. I am not talking about the million, billion dollar of, and not rupees, dollars of pulses, especially lentil, you know, the chickpea and the other, you know, lal lobia or white lobia and all those things. But the only crop where we are self-sufficient is a mung bean. And mung bean, out of 20 varieties which are available in Pakistan, 12 are developed by the Atomic Energy Commission, right? And 2 or 5 by NIFA in Peshawar. So 17 varieties are developed by only the nuclear centers of the Pakistan Atomic Commission with a very small group. And they cover 90% area and we are self-sufficient only in this crop. Similarly, in biocontrol in sugarcane, in way back in 70s, they started, you know, having the dost keede, the friendly insects which eat the bad insects. So they place the eggs on the card and you hang them so you don't have to spray. So they developed this technology in Naya Tandojam, and now all the sugar mills have taken this thing. When the farmer come to drop their sugarcane, they take the cards with them at a very cheap rate and they hang it in their new crop and they don't have to make a chemical spray. And then for the defense purposes, meal ready to eat. If our troops are, you know, serving the nation in Siachen or Haji Darapi, where round the year there is a snowfall, how they will eat or something. So they have a ready to meat biryani and chicken and everything. So it is going under radiation with the Noshera, you know, food center of the army. So we are helping them and meal ready to eat. And it was shown to people in Vienna as well as in Korea and China. And they people are, you know, really very excited to see how Pakistan Atomic Commission are serving in the food safety and food related to agriculture. Recently, only, you know, few days back, you have might have seen the PTV or GOTV or in the Dawn, the NIAP, which is another Nuclear Agriculture Center Atomic Commission. It was rated Center of Excellence. Number one, got the one award. Second award, they got the best young scientist, Mr. Dr. Kashif, and the best mutation cotton breeding program. So three awards was constituted in the post-COVID era, and all three awards were won by the Pakistan and by Pakistan Union Commission Center, NIAB. And they are going for the general conference in September in 2025, you know, in Vienna, and the award will be bestowed to the Pakistani scientists at NEAP. You know, these are the glimpses how nuclear technology can contribute for the peaceful uses, you know, for the country. Similarly, people get frightened with the radiation because of, you know, some rays come out of that. So there are some many heavy isotopes which do not emit radiation of that kind, but you can measure them due to their weight through mass spectrometry. So people are start working on that, and we are working on fertilizer use efficiency, you know, basmati rice, our geographical indication, and tobacco smuggling, halal authenticity. There are many ways, and we have established two centers, ISO certified in NIAB, again, for the, you know, in the our food chain, how these things they have impact. So in the very introductory start, you know, General Lodhi Saab has very much described about the up and downs in the agriculture. We have a lot of potential. We have sometime achieved, you know, 7% growth in agriculture. We should always remain more than 3% because our population is growing at 2.2 or 2.4%. So, but our agriculture stagnation, as General Saab has very rightly pointed out, that after Green Revolution in 60s, we reached to 40 mon, and still our average is 28 mon. This year it was 32. But good farmer, even at the same place, are getting 60 or 80. So why it is happening? You know, because the neglect. I will request from this forum to General Saab that must convey that our investment, according to International Food Policy Research Institute, Washington, D.C., this is a World Bank, that our investment in agriculture is the lowest from bottom in even SAR countries. So unless we invest, we cannot expect, you know, a problem. So we were able to convince the new government. They started, you know, in six sectors, 320 billion program for agriculture transformation, as our agriculture emergency program. Prime Minister has approved. They are ongoing now. They are, you know, on crop boosting for four crops: rice, wheat, and sugarcane, and plus oilseed. Then, you know, fishery sector, three project, water, three project, small and livestock farmers, three project, and market and the credit, you know, they have gone to 1.3 trillion, which will go to the farmers, and Kamyab Naujawan scheme, you know. So we hope that we need sustainability, that it should not be the project based, but it should go line. So we always say that such conferences and meetings, you know, we must develop the partnership, and there must be interface between science, policy, and innovation. And there must be some, you know, the last point is that because although we had several, you know, hurdles, but I hope such initiative like SBI, like many other, I am part of, you know, CGSS, and, you know, Javed Khurshid is also with another think tank. And now there is a realization, but I feel every think tank has developed, you know, food security and water security chapters as a very strong their pillar in their programs. And I hope if we keep on raising our voice, it will ultimately reach to the our, you know, ruling elites. And they must and they should understand that unless we make an investment, we cannot achieve the progress. According to Bill Gates and all things, you know, if you invest $1, it will create $3 in agriculture in the immediate, in the shortest possible time, and $8, you know, dollars in the urban, that is when it flows to the urbanized markets. So it is the in the shortest possible way, like China, bring 800 million people out of the abject poverty into a middle class. You know, so that is only possible when you invest in agriculture first and then move to industry. We went from agriculture straight to services sector. So even the manufacturing sector was remained 19% for last four decades, you know. So unless we develop agriculture, then definitely industry will develop because of it. and then we will enter into the service sector. So thank you very much for your patience listening, and I am again grateful to SBI for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with the honorable audience and including Jana Sahab. Thank you very much, sir.
Bahut shukriya, Dr. Sahab. Thank you very much, Dr. Yusuf Zafar. It was a very interesting presentation. हमें तो आपने शुरू में ही डिसआर्म कर दिया जब आपने कहा कि एग्रीकल्चर इज नॉट अ कॉमन मैन अफेयर, इट इज अ कॉम्प्लेक्स अफेयर, एंड वी एग्री विद दैट. समझते हम वैसे यही है, नॉट ओनली अबाउट एग्रीकल्चर, अबाउट एवरीथिंग. पाकिस्तानी थिंक के वी आर मास्टर्स ऑफ वी डोंट रियली आस्क द स्पेशलिस्ट. यू टॉक्ड अबाउट दैट वी डोंट ओनली नीड ग्रीन रेवोल्यूशन, वी नीड एवर ग्रीन रेवोल्यूशन व्हिच इज सस्टेनेबल. आई थिंक वेरी गुड पॉइंट. Especially for me, it was a very good teaching from your side that once we talk of food autarky, it is not only sufficiency ke ho ke uski miqdar bahut honi chahiye, uski quality bhi honi chahiye jiski requirement hai nutrition ke point of view se. I think this is a very good point. Sustainable development goals ki aapne baat ki, atom for peace ki baat ki, fir hame pata chala ke ये चूंकि जानवरों से फैलती हैं बीमारियां, तो पहले जानवरों की डिजीज जो है ना उनको कंट्रोल करने की जरूरत है. वाटर रेडिएशन, ये रेडिएशन की जो आपने बात की, मैंने खुद भुगता है कि जब मैं FFC में था तो हम कोई आम एक्सपोर्ट करना चाह रहे थे, एक हमने वो बनाया हुआ था, और हमें समझ नहीं आती जो जापान और अमरीका दोनों कहते थे कि इनकी रेडिएशन करके दें या वहां पर लाए हम रेडिएशन करेंगे. तो अगर मुझे पता होता उस वक्त कि हमारे पास लाहौर में ये फैसिलिटी है तो शायद हमारी एक्सपोर्ट जापान, जापानीज दे लाइक मैंगोज, पाकिस्तानी मैंगोज लाइक एनीथिंग, बट वी ऑल नो देयर फूड स्टैंडर्ड्स आर वेरी स्ट्रिंजेंट. वो अलाउ नहीं करते इंपोर्ट जब तक के ये सारे हर तरीके से ठीक ना हो. तो बहुत कंट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ PAEC का आपने बताया, वी आर ऑल वेरी वाइज ऑन दे. थैंक यू वेरी मच. नाउ दैट वी हैव लिसनड टू वेरी वर्दी स्पीकर्स, ऑल ऑफ देम एक्सपर्ट्स इन देयर फील्ड, आई एम श्योर वी मस्ट बी हैविंग सम क्वेश्चंस. तो कोई क्वेश्चन है हमारे पास?
यस सर, वी हैव फ्यू क्वेश्चंस सर.
ओके, पहले आप पूछ लें, फिर मेरे पास एक दो सवाल है, मैं बाद में कर लूं. तो कम अप विद द क्वेश्चन एंड अच्छा, और हमारी गुफ्तगू आगे बढ़ेगी.
राइट सर. सर द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम मिस्टर खालिद रहीम. ही हैज आस्क्ड, 6% ऑफ लैंड ओनर्स होल्ड लेस देन 5 एकर्स ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर लैंड. He's trying to compete with those with bigger holdings. Should we not plan on production reforms by creating cooperative composite small and medium farms for dairy and horticulture products, while land holding over 20 acre owners stick to the production of main crops, introducing agroforestry where feasible? Sir, he has not identified.
Basically, ये land management का सवाल है और एग्रीकल्चर बारल आउटपुट से रिलेटेड इनडायरेक्टली है. एनीवे, डॉक्टर साहिबान में से जो भी इसका जवाब देना चाहे. जी सर, आप बताइए. जी सर, आप बताइए.
वी हैव अ टू मॉडल्स, यू नो, वन मॉडल इज द यूएस और ऑस्ट्रेलिया व्हिच वी ऑलवेज ट्राई टू फॉलो, वेयर इज अ बिग लैंड होल्डिंग एंड बिग मैकेनाइजेशन प्रोसेस गोइंग ऑन. फॉर एग्जांपल, यूएसए हैज ओनली 20,000 कॉटन फार्मर एंड देयर प्रोडक्शन इज मच मोर देन पाकिस्तान. And we have 1.4 million farmers, and India has, around 6.2 million farmers. Australia has only 1,200 cotton farmers, while they are number 8 or 9 in the world production. On the other side, the China has our model, where even the land holding is smaller than even us. They have 0.17. hectare. They have another name in their own language, but they have used that if the ownership is there, modern technology is provided to them, even that can make a revolution. So we have to follow the Chinese model, not the Western model. If because of a large population is illiterate, but what is the difference between us and them? I will just narrate quickly one example. वो जो साहिर लुधियानवी went to उस जिस समय भारत और चीन आपस में भाई भाई बनते थे, वो दी वेंट टू इंडिया एंड केम बैक एंड पीपल आस्क ऑन ऑल इंडिया रेडियो व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस. ही सेड, हम वो काम करने के बाद तराने गाते हैं, हम महज तराने गाते हैं. is such a simple way to tell you're such a complex human behavior. So unless and until we start hard work by adapting modern technology, we must discipline, you know, whether it is a semester system or annual system, both are operating in the globally successfully in England and in US. But we have failed both systems because we never applied, you know, as per rules, SOPs. So small land could be one of the shortcomings, but there is a solution to that. This is the cooperative farming. You know, if the panchayat jo system tha, wo, they have decided certain things, the NGOs like SBI, they can play a role. You know, they make the farmer bodies and they started with this. But farmers are very intelligent. You know, we have now clusters. Aap patto ki mein dekhen, khud hi cluster ban gaya. Ye sari flower ka aur horticulture ka. Isi tarah ye kasoor aur is tarah khud hi haldi ka ek bahut bada Pakistan mein cluster ban gaya. Aapka 85% banana sirf Sindh se aa raha hai. ठीक है ना, जो आपकी मिर्चें हैं ये जो थर से वो आ रही हैं, कुनरी से 90% चीनी जो है लाल मिर्च वो सिर्फ वहीं से आ रही है। तो क्लस्टर खुद ब खुद किन्नू का आपका ये बलवाल और सुगोदा में बन गया। तो ये खुद ब खुद दुनिया में अब आड़ू वगैरह का स्वाद वगैरह की तरफ बन गया। तो फार्मर आर क्वाइट इंटेलिजेंट एंड दे मेक, जिस तरह अभी स्ट्रॉबेरी का हुआ या आपका लीची का हुआ, ये क्लस्टर खुद ब खुद बन जाते हैं। फार्मर आर क्वाइट शरकपुर में जिस तरह अमरूदों का बना, लाड़काने में बना, हाट में बना। सो इस पे अगर आप जाएं प्लानिंग कमीशन की एक बहुत अच्छी साइट के ऊपर, ये 33 कमोडिटीज की क्लस्टर बेस्ड स्टडी करवाई है पाकिस्तान ने 80 मिलियन रुपए खर्च करके, और वो उनकी सारी पीडीएफ फाइल्स अवेलेबल हैं इन 33 कमोडिटीज की। एंड इफ यू रीड यू विल अंडरस्टैंड कि इवन दैट कैन मेक एन इम्पैक्ट प्रोवाइडेड वी फॉलो द मॉडर्न टेक्नोलॉजीज एंड गवर्नमेंट शुड डेवलप पॉलिसीज एंड इंसेंटिव टू to make a progress. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saab. Ji Amber, next question.
Sir, I have to make a comment.
Ji, ek minute. Dr. Saab. Ji Shahji.
Yeah. Before a question is asked, I have to make a two comments on the presentations, and I have to add something which can help you understanding the things.
Please, sir.
First thing, there was a discussion that in 2002 and 2004, National Biotechnology Commission was formed. It was a project of 3 years, which was taken from the Planning Commission. I was the project director for that, and Anwar Naseem and Kausar Malik, the pioneer in biotechnology, was running that. And through that project, we were able to develop 18 institutes in different universities and different provinces. And the thinking was that these institutes, along with the commission, when it will be developed, will be able to take the biotechnology in Pakistan, and which we were unable to do it. One comment. Second, you talked about the radiation sterilization techniques and in the food. First radiation sterilization by the name of Paras was developed in Lahore, and it was doing the radiation of single medical products. And beside that, now we have developed two other centers which are radiating food and fruits for the export purposes.
Ye kahan par hai Dr. Saab, ye jo do aur bane?
Jo do aur bane, ek to Paras hi Lahore mein develop hua hai, और दूसरा जो है वो हम कराची में डेवलप हो रहा है, और वो दोनों को टेक ओवर करेगा, और दे आर फास्ट टेक्निक्स एंड द कोबाल्ट 60 रेडिएशन टेक्निक, बिकॉज़ फर्स्ट प्लांट वाज ऑन द कोबाल्ट 60 रेडिएशन, नाउ इट इज ऑफ द अल्ट्रावायलेट रेडिएशंस, एंड बाय दैट वी आर स्टर्लाइजिंग।
बहुत शुक्रिया जी, बहुत शुक्रिया, थैंक यू वेरी मच जी। अंबर बेटे, नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन।
The next question is from Ms. Aisha Vadul. My question is, many countries ban GM crops. Even there are problems in exports of GM crops. So why are we doing genetic engineering? Please throw light in this perspective.
मतलब basically आप ये पूछना चाह रही हैं वो कि GM crops जो हैं या GM जो food है वो बाकी countries ने reject कर दिया है, तो हम क्यों बनाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं?
डॉक्टर साहब
कोई भी इसमें जवाब दे दे। डॉक्टर शौके साहब आप देखिए,
मैं इसमें कमेंट करना चाहूंगा मैं कौन सा
जी जी
बेसिकली करंटली इफ वी सी द इंटरनेशनल सिनेरियो 70 कंट्रीज हैव अडॉप्टेड जीएम क्रॉप्स आउट ऑफ 70 26 कंट्रीज दे आर कमर्शियली कल्टीवेटिंग बट अदर 45 दे हैव दे इंपोर्ट जीएम क्रॉप्स और सीड्स फॉर देयर फूड फीड एंड प्रोसेसिंग पर्पस including Europe. Europe has banned cultivation, but they allow the import of GM seeds. Annually, according to FAO figure, which is available, 30 million tons GM corn or soybean, which Europe imports annually. So basically, these are some national issues. There is no country in this space that has banned GM crops until now, that there are no hazards. कोई रिपोर्ट हुए हैं कोई एनवायरमेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से या हेल्थ पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से ऐसा कोई बैन अभी पूरी दुनिया में कोई सामने नहीं आया सम कंट्रीज दे डोंट अलाउ इवन कल्टीवेशन दे डोंट अलाउ इवन एफएफपीज इंपोर्ट बट दे अलाउ द एटरी रिसर्च ऑन आरएनडी ऑन द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ जीएम क्रॉप्स और ट्रांसजेनिक क्रॉप्स तो दीज आर वेरिएबल लेवल्स ऑफ एक्सेप्टेंस एंड नेशनल लेवल बेस्ड डिसीजंस
ठीक है कोई और क्योंकि इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन है कोई शाहजी आप या डॉक्टर यूसुफ साहब आप कोई डॉक्टर यूसुफ आपको ऐड करना चाहेंगे
मैं इसमें ये कह रहा हूँ कि दुनिया की जो इस वक्त जो 7 अरब आबादी है उसमें सर आप देखिए कि अमेरिका ब्राज़ील अर्जेंटीना चाइना इंडिया ये और पाकिस्तान 220 मिलियन लोग हैं कॉटन हमारे बंदे जीएम तो जो उसमें स्वाय यूरोप जिसने अपने मुल्क में ग्रोइंग बैन की है सिर्फ लेकिन इस्तेमाल वो भी करते हैं इन टर्म्स ऑफ फीड इन टर्म्स ऑफ प्रोसेस फूड सोयाबीन और सारे ये डेयरी के लिए तो वो 5 जो अरब लोग हैं वो तो खा रहे हैं दिन रात वो जीएम से तो वो ये प्रोपेगेंडा ज्यादा है ये कॉमन मैन के लिए हकीकत इसके बरक्स है
ठीक बहुत शुक्रिया जी अमर बेटे नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन
सर द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम डॉक्टर काशिफ अमीर ही हैज आस्क्ड इज देयर एनी वे टू अवॉइड untraceability and authenticity issues to prevent fraud in case of GM crops, especially BT cotton, as people are making huge gains by selling fraudulent BT seeds in Pakistan. Sir, he has not identified any speaker.
अच्छा जी, इसमें मेरा ख्याल है डॉक्टर शौकत साहब भी इसको देख सकते हैं कि वो ये कह रहे हैं कि जी इसकी जो इसमें जो मैल प्रैक्टिसेस हैं सीड के बेचने में कैसे इसका इसको कैसे इस पर इसका सद्देबाव हो सकता है क्या इसकी आइडेंटिफिकेशन वगैरह का या क्या सिस्टम है आई थिंक समथिंग ऑन दैट थॉट जी जी डॉक्टर साहब
या देयर आर इश्यूज बट बेसिकली सो फार इन पाकिस्तान सर देयर आर 4 रेफरेंस लैबोरेटरी जो कि डिक्लेयर की गई हैं जो कि इसकी टेस्टिंग में इन्वॉल्व हैं जिसमें फैसलाबाद है कैम लाहौर है और यूब एग्रीकल्चर रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट फैसलाबाद है एक तो वहाँ पर इसकी टेस्टिंग भी होती है एनुअली हमारे पास डिफरेंट सैंपल्स भी आते हैं सबके पास जाते हैं दे हैव स्टेट ऑफ द आर्ट और एक्रीडेटेड फैसिलिटीज इवन फॉर द टेस्टिंग सो इसकी ट्रेसिबिलिटी के लिए बेसिकली जो है जो इसकी कहने के वो हमारा फेडरल सीड सर्टिफिकेशन भी है जो उसकी जो नॉर्मल सर्टिफाई करता है सीड्स को अगर अनफॉर्चुनेटली प्रॉब्लम उसके ये कि उसकी कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग और उसकी जो स्ट्रेंथ बहुत वीक है इस मामले में तो ये एक डिफरेंट है अगर समवन इंटरेस्टेड उसकी अपनी फार्मर लेवल पे कुछ सीड की ऑथेंटिसिटी के व्हाट ऑफ काइंड ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी को जो जिस क्लेम पे उसने फार्मर ने खरीदा है या किसी कंपनी ने प्रोवाइड की है उसकी टेस्टिंग पाकिस्तान में पॉसिबल है
बहुत शुक्रिया एक इससे मिलता जुलता सवाल मेरे दिन में भी था मैंने कहा आपसे अभी पूछ लेता हूँ कि अभी भी हमने देखा है कि हालांकि बहुत डेवलप हमने सीड किए हैं या लोकली लेकिन जब हम सब्जियों के सीड लेने जाते हैं या कोई फिर हमें इम्पोर्टेड सीड ही लेने पड़ते हैं तो जिसका ये मतलब ये है कि हम रिसर्च तो कर रहे हैं और हमने प्रोड्यूस भी कर ली है वैरायटीज़ बट उन वैरायटीज़ को अवेलेबल फार्मर्स के लिए करना या सब्जियों के बीज वगैरह अवेलेबल करने में हम नाकाम क्यों हैं हमें अभी भी जो इंटरनेशनल कंपनीज हैं वो सेंटो वगैरह जो भी उनका नाम है उनसे लेने पड़ते हैं इसकी क्या वजह है
सर उसकी
ये सर क्रॉप्स की आता तो
जी जी पहले डॉक्टर शौकत साहब कर दें फिर मैं आपकी तरफ आता हूं डॉक्टर साहब जी जी डॉक्टर शौकत
सर मैं इसमें ये कहना चाहूंगा कि क्रॉप्स की जो जो हमारी मेजर क्रॉप्स हैं वीट कॉटन राइस इसकी हद तक तो मैं समझता हूँ कि अवेलेबिलिटी जो आप सही फरमा रहे हैं कि जो वेजिटेबल का सेक्टर है इसमें हमारी इस वक्त कह लें कि टोटली इम्पोर्ट है सीड के बारे में। तो अगेन इश्यूज सर वही है बेसिकली जो पहले हमारे एक तो वहाँ जो कह लें कि जो प्लांट बेस्ड राइट्स की इम्प्लीमेंटेशन है वो पाकिस्तान में बहुत लेट हुई। अभी रिसेंटली इस साल रूल्स हमारे एक्ट बना 2016 में, देन वी सी द प्लांट बेस्ड राइट एक्ट रूल्स इन 2018। रूल्स बनने के बाद भी हमने 3 साल मजीद उसमें गवा दिए कि 2021 में जाके उसकी इम्प्लीमेंटेशन अभी भी 5 क्रॉप्स पे स्टार्ट हुई है। तो मैं समझ इसमें रेगुलेशन का भी बहुत फुकदान रहा है, अवेलेबिलिटी ऑफ सर्टिफाइड सीड। इवन हमारी जो मेजर क्रॉप्स कॉटन की अगर बात करें तो कॉटन का 50% सीड भी अवेलेबल नहीं है सर्टिफाइड पाकिस्तान में। तो अदारों की स्ट्रेंथनिंग बड़ी इंपॉर्टेंट है इसमें है, ये भी एक इशूज है। जहाँ तक रिसर्च पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से रिसर्च सर हैज कंट्रीब्यूटेड, आई थिंक वेजिटेबल्स का सेक्टर डेफिनेटली इग्नोर रहा है पाकिस्तान में, इसमें उतनी ज्यादा हमारी किसी रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट की भी इतनी कंट्रीब्यूशन नहीं है जो मेरे ख्याल में है।
ठीक है, थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर यूसुफ साहब। आप जब जवाब देंगे तो काइंडली ये भी इसमें ऐड करें कि कहीं ऐसा तो नहीं है कि ये जो हम रेगुलेशंस बनाते हैं ये हमारे ऊपर कोई ऐसी इम्पोज की जाती है बाहर से ताकि हम अपने पैरों पर खड़े ना हो सकें, कहीं ऐसी बात तो नहीं है डॉक्टर यूसुफ साहब?
सर इसमें कोई कॉन्स्पिरेसी थ्योरी नहीं है, अनफॉर्चुनेटली इट इज अवर ओन निग्लेक्ट। आप 17 वेजिटेबल हैं एक सीजन में, आप वो कद्दू टींडे खीरा ये सारा जी, एक आप एक बात बस भूल जाते हैं, अक्सर हमारे जो तो रूलिंग एलीट्स है कि आप सारा साल आप खीरा खा रहे हैं, तो किसी ने काम किया है ना,
40,000 एकड़
से 40,000 एकड़ पे चली गई है। हम कद्दू करेले हमें सारा साल मिलते हैं, ठीक है ना, तो काम हुआ है कहीं। लेकिन अब 17 वेजिटेबल्स के ऊपर अगर आपके पास 3 साइंटिस्ट हैं अयूब एग्रीकल्चर में और उन्हें भी तनख्वाह लेट मिलती है, उनकी प्रमोशन नहीं होती, उनको कोई पैसे नहीं मिलते, 6 महीने पिछले दिनों कॉटन 6 महीने ये 2021 की बात कर रहा हूँ, 6 महीने कॉटन रिसर्च जो हमारा सेंट्रल इंस्टीट्यूट है फेडरल गवर्नमेंट का इन मुल्तान सकरण, उन्हें 6 महीने तनख्वाह नहीं मिली। तो सारे एम्प्लॉयज को ड्यू टू वो एक लीगल मसला था सेस का, बहरहाल टू कट शॉर्ट आपको मैं ये सिर्फ बता दूँ द गुड न्यूज़। अगर आपको सर जनरल साहब अगर आपको मौका मिले आप कभी मामू कांजन जाए और वहाँ मियाँ शौकत ने युक्सल टर्की की कंपनी है उससे मिलके 5 वेजिटेबल सीड हैं उसका इतना बड़ा सेटअप लगाया है कि वो हाइब्रिड सीड हम खीरे के खरबूजे के शिमला मिर्च के कद्दू के करेले के 5 जो अभी उन्होंने सेलेक्ट किए हैं एंड वी आर एक्सपोर्टिंग टू रशियन फेडरेशन टू जॉर्डन टू मेनी कंट्रीज।
अच्छा
वर्थ सीइंग है, अगर किसी ने नहीं देखा कि पाकिस्तान में माहू कांजन में ये मिरेकल हो सकता है, वो आपको कई हजार एकड़ के ऊपर जो आपको नजर आएंगे ग्रीन हाउसेस वेजिटेबल पैकिंग, औरतें सर 9,000 औरतें सीजन में काम करती हैं फॉर क्रॉसिंग, उनके 3 बच्चे उसमें इन्वॉल्व हैं एंड टर्की की मदद से वो बनाया है। इसी तरह अगर हम चाइना की मदद से हम ये शुरू कर दें जिस तरह हमने हाइब्रिड सीड में गार्ड वालों ने शुरू किया है, तो सर अगर गवर्नमेंट मुझे एक दफ़ा एक वैसे जब मेरा डिनर था तो उसमें US वाले ने कहा कि द बिगेस्ट हर्डल इन योर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन PRC जहाँ शौकत काम करता है प्रोग्रेस इज योर ओन मिनिस्ट्री, दे आर क्रिएटिंग हर्डल जो हमारी ब्यूरोक्रेसी है फॉर डिफरेंट, ये तो दे आर नॉट अलाउइंग थिंग्स टू हैपन। तो पाकिस्तान में लॉट ऑफ पोटेंशियल है, पीपल आर एक्टिव, प्राइवेट सेक्टर को आना चाहिए, हमारा काम सर रिसर्च का हो। ये SPD को मैंने कई दफ़ा समझाया है कि वी शुड नॉट एंटर इनटू कमर्शियलाइजेशन, हमारा काम है अच्छे रोड ट्रांसपोर्ट के रूल्स बनाने, बस चलाना हमारा काम नहीं है सरकार का, रोड ट्रांसपोर्ट अथॉरिटी हमारी तगड़ी हो लेकिन बस प्राइवेट ही चलाए। लेकिन डाइव मूवर आई फैसल मूवर आए इन्होंने दे हैव चेंज द सीन। तो में भी इंशाल्लाह सर आप बड़ी जल्द देखेंगे कि जिस तरह हाइब्रिड सीड में अब गार्ड वाले आ गए, ओरिगा वाले आ गए, 4B वाले आ गए, कॉटन जिसने शौकत ने बताया 4B, और ये प्राइवेट सेक्टर जब आएगा रिसर्च ले जिस तरह USDA की तरह सरकारी इदारों से, उसको मल्टीप्लाई कमर्शलाइजेशन मार्केटिंग वो करे प्राइवेट सेक्टर,
प्राइवेट सेक्टर
इंशाल्लाह काम चलेगा।
बहुत शुक्रिया डॉक्टर साहब जी। बेटे और सवाल हैं?
Sir, Dr. Kashyap Amir has further added, and he said, I have worked and published in domain of food biotechnology. Consumer acceptability is one of the major issues to tackle, even in case of GM food commodities and irradiated foods. Kindly guide my modality to overcome reluctance faced by intended consumer. Please give your input.
ये तो खैर ये डॉक्टर साहबान से तो सवाल नहीं, तो एक जनरल नॉलेज का सवाल है कि भी लोगों को कैसे कन्विंस किया जाए कि ये चीजें मुजर सेहत नहीं है और अच्छी है. लेकिन अगर कोई आप कोई मशवरा देना चाहें डॉक्टर साहबान तो दे सकते हैं.
सर अवेयरनेस कैंपेन ही है, नॉलेज वो जिस तरह अमेरिका में है वॉलमार्ट में, वो कहता है वो जो आपको रात को नाइट शो करता है, वो कहता है कि यू गो 80,000 प्रोडक्ट्स, इवन द स्टैचू ऑफ न्यूयॉर्क इज मेड इन चाइना. सो कीप ऑन टेलिंग कि यार ये सारी चीजें दे आर इरेडिएटेड एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम, और आपको एक्सरे कराते हैं अपने कैंसर का इलाज कराते हैं, तो रेडिएशन आर यूजफुल आल्सो.
जी मेरी नजर में इसका जवाब ये है कि ये जितने ये एक्टर्स जो लक्स के इश्तिहार में आते हैं इन सबको खाते हुए दिखाए ना जीएम फूड, तो मेरा ख्याल ये मशहूर हो जाएगा. जी और कोई सवाल है?
यस सर, द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम मिस आयुषा खान. शी हैज आस्क्ड इट फ्रॉम डॉक्टर शौकत अली. सर, यू हैव मेंशनड द नीड फॉर नेशनल बायोटेक्नोलॉजी पॉलिसी. सो माय क्वेश्चन इज व्हाट शुड बी द मेन कंपोनेंट ऑफ सच नेशनल पॉलिसी इफ पाकिस्तान इज टू डेवलप वन.
जी डॉक्टर साहब.
यस आई थिंक यू मेंशनड अर्लियर के जो उसमें जो मेन कंपोनेंट्स जो पॉलिसी के हैं उसमें सबसे पहले के व्हाट वी आवर प्रायोरिटाइज क्रॉप्स, हमें हर क्रॉप में ये जीएमओ या जी बनाने की जरूरत नहीं है. वेयर वी नीड आवर नेचुरल बायोडाइवर्सिटी स्टॉक अप या हमारी जो नेचुरल जो ब्रीडिंग है वो स्टॉक, वहाँ पे इसका एप्लीकेशन होना चाहिए. पहले तो क्रॉप्स को आइडेंटिफाई करें कि हमें कहाँ जरूरत है. देन उन क्रॉप्स के अंदर व्हाट आर द ट्रेड्स, कौन से ट्रेड्स हैं जो कि ब्रेक थ्रू साबित हो सकते हैं फ्रॉम यील्ड पॉइंट ऑफ या नेशनल फूड सिक्योरिटी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से, हमें उन ट्रेड्स को आइडेंटिफाई करना चाहिए. ठीक है. देन हर कैपेसिटी ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूट्स पोटेंशियल, किस इंस्टीट्यूट में क्या पोटेंशियल है. इट्स नॉट नेसेसरी कि हर इंस्टीट्यूट जो है, इससे भी फायदा है कि वी कैन अवॉइड डुप्लीकेशन ऑफ वर्क, वी कैन रैशनलाइज आवर यूज ऑफ बजट एंड अदर थिंग्स. सो ये मेरे ख्याल में ये तीन चार कॉम्पोनेंट्स मेजर पॉलिसी के होने चाहिए.
थैंक यू. थैंक यू डॉक्टर साहब. और भी कोई सवाल है? मैं दो सवाल लेके मैं बैठा हुआ हूँ.
Sir, you can ask. Sir, we are also running short of time. Sir, you can ask.
अच्छा ठीक है, बहुत शुक्रिया. दो मेरे जहन में चीजें हैं. एक तो हमारे यहाँ, मैंने क्योंकि सफर किया, आप लोग भी देखते रहते हैं, हमारे यहाँ खजूरें बहुत ज़ाया होती हैं, बहुत ज्यादा डोके की सूरत में खत्म हो जाती हैं. उसके बाद जब खजूरें आती हैं मार्केट में तो वो उनकी क्वालिटी भी नहीं होती जो बाहर से हम देखते हैं, और उनके छुहारे बना के शायद इंडिया भेज देते हैं या क्या करते हैं. तो आप में से किसी के जहन में अगर हो कि ये डेट प्रोसेसिंग को किस तरीके से तरवीज दी जाए, एक तो ये, दूसरा ये कि दूसरा सवाल साथ ही मैं कर देता हूँ कि पेरिशेबल हमारे वेजिटेबल्स और फ्रूट जो हैं उनका बड़ा बुरा हाल है. कभी टमाटर बढ़ गए या कभी कोई चीज़ ज़्यादा हो गई, कम हो गई, फिर हमें समझ नहीं आती अब इसका क्या करें. हमारे दूर दराज से फ्रूट आते हैं, ये जापानी फ्रूट है, ये आड़ू है, और चीज़ें हैं वहाँ पर जो ऊपर नॉर्दर्न एरिया से आती हैं, तो वो लोग जब जैसे अंजीर है उसको वो सुखा के वो रस्सियों के ऊपर वो तो तरीका है, लेकिन जैसे प्रॉपर मॉडर्न तरीके से इनको प्रिजर्व करना और इनको एज ए ड्राई फ्रूट बेचना, ये क्या क्या मसला है इसको? कोई है हमारे यहाँ ऐसा इंस्टीट्यूट या इसके लिए अलग बनाना पड़ेगा?
सर मैं इसका आपका खजूर का जवाब दे दूँ, क्योंकि बिकॉज आई वॉज इन्वॉल्व इन डिवेलपिंग द. एक तो आपको इस पे जो आपने कहा है इस पर अगर आपने कुछ थोड़ा सा मजीद पढ़ना है तो ये डेट्स के ऊपर प्लानिंग कमीशन की वेबसाइट पे, ये PDR यानी प्लानिंग डेवलपमेंट एंड रिफॉर्म गवर्नमेंट ऑफ पाकिस्तान की वेबसाइट खोलें तो आपको खजूर के ऊपर कोई 100 सफ़ों का PDF मिल जाएगी सारी कि प्रोसेसिंग में क्या किया जा सकता है. अगर आपको प्रैक्टिकल एग्जांपल लेना है तो ये मनकेरा की तरफ ये जो आपका थल डेजर्ट है इसमें सर ये फौज ने ज़मीन अब अलॉट की है जनरल जुनेद साहब को, ये जो डेस्टो के चीफ थे और इंजीनियरिंग कोर के ही हैं आपके, तो उन्होंने खजूर का बहुत बड़ा बाग लगाया है. उन्होंने एक मुरब्बा ज़मीन 7 और किराए पे भी ले ली है और उन्होंने प्रोसेसिंग बाहर से उन्होंने भी इंपोर्ट की है खजूर का, वो सारा मैं देख के आया था. मैंने इस पे ईरान पे मुझे अताउर रहमान साहब ने भेजा था. बसरा में के साथ जो ईरानी इलाका है वहाँ खजूर सारी जंग 10 साल जो चली तबाह हो गई थी, तो उन्होंने अपने 6 मिलियन यानी 60 लाख पौधों को रिप्लेस करना था, तो उन्होंने टिश्यू कल्चर की सारी फैसिलिटी डेवलप की विद द हेल्प ऑफ यूके और वो 40 लाख पौधे लगा चुके हैं छोटे कद के। और इसी तरह मोदी ने गुजरात में राजस्थान में बहुत काम किया है, बहुत ज़्यादा, और उन्होंने हमसे छुआरे लेने बंद कर दिए। छुआरे जो है ना वो इसीलिए लेते हैं कि हमारी प्रोसेसिंग की जो चेन है वो स्ट्रॉन्ग नहीं थी। अब जब इनको मार पड़ी है और मोदी ने आके पाकिस्तान से छुआरे जो 85% हमारी खिदमत दी वो लेने बंद किए हैं, तो हमने ऑल्टरनेट मार्केट्स बांग्लादेश श्रीलंका वगैरह में ढूंढी हैं और उसमें हमें बड़ी कामयाबी मिली है और वो महंगी भी बिकती हैं और जो है पाकिस्तान अर्न मोर, हमारी जो है 200-300 मिलियन डॉलर की एक्सपोर्ट है ये, तो पाकिस्तान का अच्छा मौका है प्रोसेसिंग। सर आप जुनेद साहब से बात कर लीजिए, उन्होंने अपनी साइट के ऊपर लगा रहे हैं पैकेजिंग और प्रोसेसिंग का प्लांट।
चलें बड़ी अच्छी बात, दैट इज ग्रेट। ये डॉक्टर
जी, और दूसरी बात जो आपने की है ये पेरिशेबल की, सर सर वो देखें वही बात आ जाती है कि अगर गवर्नमेंट को जो आर्काइक रूल्स को नहीं बदलेगी, मार्केट कमेटी का रूल जो 1918 का बना हुआ है अगर वही चलेगा, हम मॉडर्न मार्केट्स नहीं बनाएंगे, मार्केट कमेटियां सियासी तौर पे चलती हैं और वही 34-35 बड़ी मार्केट्स हैं, वो आपको आरती जो है वो एक्सप्लॉइट करता है, वो नहीं चलने दे रहा सिस्टम को, तो उसको कोई क्योंकि वो सारा पॉलिटिकल इलीट के साथ जो कनेक्शन है तो वो उसका एक कंट्रोल है। जब तक हम उस शैकल को नहीं तोड़ेंगे हमारे मुल्क में ये एग्रीकल्चर की जो आपने कहा है कि जी जो पोस्ट हार्वेस्ट लॉसेज ये सारी चीज़ें ये नहीं ठीक होंगी, जहाँ तक आपने नॉर्थ का जिक्र किया, अब ये सी पैक की वजह से रूट जो खुला है तो आपने देखा होगा कि इस साल खुबानी और ये बाकी चीज़ें भी ज़्यादा आनी शुरू होंगी। इसी तरह मोटरवे ने किन्नू की जिस तरह सेक्टर खोला है, इसी तरह आप देखेंगे कि ये जो है सी पैक की वजह से काफ़ी जब ये ओपन होगा तो फिर हमारे जो है ना ये पेरिशेबिलिटी।
जी बहुत शुक्रिया, बहुत शुक्रिया डॉक्टर सैयद जावेद खुर्शीद साहब। अगर आप कोई भी जितने सवाल वगैरह हुए हैं या जो आखिर में मैंने पूछे कोई बात अगर आप करना चाहें, मौजूद है डॉक्टर साहब?
चले गए?
अच्छा चलिए, मेरा ख्याल आपका टाइम भी खत्म हो गया, जूम का आपने टाइम लिया हुआ था 1 बजे तक, तो दैट इज ऑल। मैं बहुत मशहूर हूँ डॉक्टर शौकत आपका, यूसुफ जफर साहब डॉक्टर साहब, डॉक्टर जावेद खुर्शीद साहब का, बहुत हमारी मालूमात में इजाफा हुआ है। मैं सिर्फ आपको एक चीज़ ऐड कर दूँ, मैं जब FFC में MD था तो मुझे जो सबसे ज़्यादा फ़ायदा पहुँचा कंपनी को साफ ज़ाहिर है वो एक एग्रीकल्चर डॉक्टर साहब ही थे, डॉक्टर ज़िया उनका नाम है, मुनीर ज़िया, उनकी वजह से पहुँचा वो, मैं तफसीलात में मैं नहीं जाता, तो जहाँ भी तौकीर की जाएगी आप साहिबान की वहीं पर फ़ायदा होगा और मुल्क भी अगर आपको आपका मुकाम दे और जिस तरीके से आप चाहते हैं कि सारे चीज़ों को कोऑर्डिनेट करें। एग्रीकल्चर बेशक अभी इन्होंने ये प्रोविंशियल सब्जेक्ट कर दिया है, लेकिन जैसे आप कह रहे थे जब तक कोऑर्डिनेट ना करें हम इसके एफर्ट्स उस तक जो है ना ये सारा मामला ठीक नहीं होगा। इंशाल्लाह जहाँ तक हो सका हम ये सारी जो आपकी रिकमेंडेशंस हैं ये इकट्ठी करके हम गवर्नमेंट को बाकायदा भिजवाएंगे और मेरा भी जब तक जहाँ तक मुझे मिला मौका मैं भी इन चीज़ों को आगे पहुँचाऊँगा। आप लोगों के हम बहुत मशहूर हैं, आपने अपना टाइम निकाला और बेशुमार टाइम निकाला और हमारे साथ रहे, तो बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। थैंक यू वेरी मच एवरीवन हु वाज विद अस एंड इंशाल्लाह सी यू नेक्स्ट टाइम। अल्लाह हाफिज़, बहुत शुक्रिया, थैंक यू,
थैंक यू सो मच सर, थैंक यू सर।